Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. I'm Ellis Jacob, and I'm going to talk about growing up Jewish in China. People ask me who I am or where I came from, and I tell them I'm an Iraqi Jew from China. And the question always arises, what were you doing there, and how did your family get there? Now, to answer those questions, you have to go back about 175 years, back to about 1840. And in 1840, England was importing tea from China and enjoying the tea. China had a worldwide monopoly on tea. They didn't allow tea plants to get out of the country, although some were smuggled out later and formed tea plantations in Asia and Africa. Well, they were enjoying tea, and the Chinese demanded payment in silver. And paying for tea in silver was depleting the British treasury, and they needed something to replace that money going to China. And that something was opium. The British found opium. The profits from opium were mind-boggling, and they used to ship opium to China. And the Chinese soon found out that opium was destroying their population. If you're addicted to opium, you're no good to anyone, including yourself. So the Chinese tried to tax it, confiscate it, throw it into the sea. And the British said, you can't do that, we're going to go to war. And they went to war with China for the right to sell opium to China. And they won the war. They won the war, and in 1842, there was a peace treaty in Nanking, or now called Nanjing. And this peace treaty was probably the most one-sided peace treaty ever written. The British got everything, and the Chinese got nothing. And one of the things the British got was the right not to be subjected to Chinese law in five ports called treaty ports. And these five treaty ports were Hong Kong, Canton, Amoy, Fuzhou, and Shanghai. So the British come along in Shanghai, and they want to settle in Shanghai. And Shanghai was a little fishing village, population 6,000 with a wall around it to prevent pirates from coming in. And the Chinese said, well, you can settle over there. And over there was the muddy banks of a muddy river. But the British were industrious. They kept driving piles into the ground, kept going down and down and down. And when they hit solid rock, they built a city. And Shanghai grew rapidly, probably the fastest growing place in the history of the world. To give you an example, in 1840, Shanghai was a population of 6,000, little fishing village. In 1940, Shanghai was a thriving metropolis. Fifth largest city in the world, population 6 million. So in 100 years, Shanghai grew 1,000 times. In those days, Shanghai was governed by the Shanghai Municipal Council, formed in 1863. There were no Chinese representatives in the Shanghai Municipal Council, and Chinese had no rights in the international settlement. And foreigners, Caucasians, had special privileges. Life was good. We were privileged. We were a privileged society, and I called it a parasitic society. The Chinese had all the menial jobs, the low-paying jobs, and the Caucasians had all the upper-paying jobs. That's the way it was. Life was good. Well, how did my family get there? What does this have to do with my family? My family originated in Iraq. On my father's side, my family lived in and around Baghdad. And on my mother's side, the family came from Basra, both towns prominent in the recent Iraq war. On my father's side, the young man who became my grandfather had two younger brothers, and the family was very poor, extremely poor, and the two younger brothers shared one pair of shoes. it was tough. So the youngest brother had saved some money, and he went into the bazaar in Baghdad to buy himself a pair of shoes when an anti-Jewish riot took place. Jews were attacked on the streets, Jewish businesses were burned, and this little boy of 7 was hit on the head with a rock, and he lay there on the streets, bleeding, unconscious, left there to die. Luckily, someone recognized this little boy and carried him back to his mother, my great-grandmother. And she said, "We have to get out of here. We have to get out of here." She was put in touch with David Sassoon. Now, David Sassoon was an Iraqi Jewish businessman who left Iraq and went to Bombay, India, now called Mumbai. And he started a business. He sold top quality cotton, and he sold opium to China. The British encouraged people to send opium to China. That's where the money was. Now, in those days, everything was done by hand. There was no computers, typewriters, calculators, any machines. Everything was done by hand. All the accounts, all the recording was done by hand. And David Sassoon would give anyone a job who could read and write. And the young man who became my grandfather went to a French missionary school in Baghdad, and he could read and write. And he spoke Arabic and he spoke English. He got a job right on the spot. And the family moved to Bombay. And his two younger brothers also joined the business and learned the business fast. Now, David Sassoon was a sharp businessman. He invested his profits wisely. When he made his profits, he invested in real estate around Bombay, and he invested in real estate in this far-off place called Shanghai, which was growing rapidly. Now, Shanghai was growing rapidly because in the countryside, there were uprisings against the central government, which was very corrupt, very unpopular, and very corrupt. And the population was afraid. There was violence, there was all kinds of political activity, and people flocked into the cities. So they were flocking into Shanghai at a rapid rate. So real estate was in very high demand, very high demand. So he bought money, bought real estate in Shanghai. And after a while, his investments were considerable, and he needed someone to manage that real estate. The young man who became my grandfather learned the business well, knew the business, so he was sent to Shanghai to manage the real estate of David Sassoon. And he arrived around the turn of the century, around 1900. And you have to picture this Jewish man trying to keep kosher in an area where kosher didn't exist, okay? He's trying to keep kosher. So he's managing the business, and one day he sees this pretty little girl playing hopscotch on the streets of Shanghai. She had just arrived with her father. Her father's name was Sassoon Abraham, and he was going to be the Hazan of the newly formed Sephardic Jewish community. There were Iraqi Jews who were coming into Shanghai because that's where the jobs were. You know, John Dillinger, the bank robber, was asked, "How come you rob banks?" And he says, "That's where the money is." Okay, that's where the money is. Well, people came to Shanghai because that's where the jobs were. Jobs were plentiful for Caucasians. So my grandfather goes to the father of this little girl and says, "I want to marry your daughter." So the man interviews this young man, who is now in his late 20s, and he finds out he's got all the credentials of being a good son-in-law. He knows Hebrew, he knows the prayers, he knows the rituals, the customs, he knows all of that. He would attend synagogue on Friday night, what there was at that time. So he calls in his daughter from the playing hopscotch on the streets of Shanghai, and he says, "You're getting married." That was it. Nothing more was said. "You're getting married." And so this man of almost 30 marries this young girl of 15, and they produce 10 children. My father was the second son of 10 children. Now, Shanghai in those days, I have to say, was dominated by the British. Everyone spoke English. You didn't need to speak Chinese. It was run by the Shanghai Municipal Council, and everything with British customs, British laws, all, everything was dominated by the British. My father went to a British school, the same British school that I went to in my term. And my family, on my mother's side, arrived right after World War I. My mother was born in India, so she was a British subject. She had a British passport. My parents met and married in 1930, and I was born a year later. So I grew up in this British-dominated society, and life was good. Life was good. Like I say, we were a privileged, parasitic society. Things were good. I went to the British school, and the British system is such that boys and girls are together at kindergarten. And after that, the boys go to the boys' school and the girls go to the girls' school. So I went to a boys' school. And things went well. World War II broke out, but World War II was thousands of miles away. Didn't bother us, didn't even affect us. It didn't affect us until Pearl Harbor Day. Pearl Harbor Day came. While you recognize it, December 7th, we were on the other side of the international dateline. We recognize it as December 8th. And December 8th, 1941, the Japanese, who had been sending troops to Shanghai, they had invaded China in 1937. They invaded China. They had plans to take over all of China in 3 months. Well, that didn't work out. They didn't even leave Shanghai in 3 months because the Chinese put up this tremendous resistance. And there was fighting going on all around the city in 1937. In fact, I remember an incident when I was 6 years old. When I was 6 years old, I was up on the roof of our apartment building, and I was raised by an ama, a maid. Because both my parents worked, and my ama bathed me, fed me, dressed me, and so on like that. We were on the roof of this apartment building, and I was 6 years old, and suddenly there were two tremendous explosions. We didn't know what happened. My ama just picked me up, and we went downstairs. And we found out later the Japanese had bombed a major intersection in Shanghai. About 500 people were killed. And that's the way things were. Fighting went on around the city. I was loaned a scrapbook by a friend of mine whose father clipped out articles about the war between Chinese and Japanese and pictures. And I looked at those, I referred to those. I wrote a book about my experiences, and I used some of that in the book. On the back of these pictures and articles, there were ads for concerts, sporting events, parties. The Chinese and Japanese were killing each other 3 miles away, and we were having concerts and parties and sporting events like nothing was going on. Life went on as normal until Pearl Harbor Day. Pearl Harbor Day came, and 3 hours after the Japanese had attacked Pearl Harbor, they swarmed across the city in Shanghai. There was an American patrol boat, river patrol boat, docked. They swarmed on there, and it was so fast the Americans didn't have a chance to destroy the secret codes. And There was a British patrol boat anchored in the middle of the river about a mile back. So they boarded the little British patrol boat and they said, "We're now at war. We have guns trained on you right now. Please surrender." The British Navy has a tradition. No British ship has ever surrendered. And the captain was not about to change that now. And he said, "Get off my ship!" and threw off the Japanese, but they were ready. They had a huge heavy cruiser with big guns trained on this little patrol boat, 30-foot patrol boat. Big guns, and they had artillery on both sides, and we heard explosions at 2:30 in the morning. Didn't know what happened. Big explosions, flashes of light, machine gun fire, big explosion that lasted about 20 minutes, and then silence. When we woke up the next morning, Japanese troops were everywhere. They had machine guns set up at major intersections, and they had signs on the buildings and trees in three languages, English, Chinese, and Japanese. "You are now under military occupation. You will obey the orders of the military commander." Okay, life suddenly changed. They set up a new government, a puppet government, where there was a Chinese prime minister, but he did the dictates of the Japanese. Now, I want to point out, as I was growing up, the Chinese left us alone. They even welcomed Jews to China. We had a synagogue. I attended a synagogue called the Ohel Rachel Synagogue. It was financed by the grandson of David Sassoon, whose wife had passed away. Her name was Rachel, and he paid for and had built the synagogue in her memory. And I went to the Ohel Rachel Synagogue. And the Japanese came along, occupied the city. And Shanghai, to get an idea, Shanghai was considered the international settlement, the French concession. The French demanded and got a land there as a concession, and then many, many little villages all around. It's really three towns in one. And the Japanese occupied the city. The new government, the prime minister of the new government was a Chinese man by the name of Wang Qingwei. And Wang Qingwei was considered a traitor by the Chinese for being part of this government. But we had a new government, new currency, and new police force. The new currency was issued by a new bank called the Central Reserve Bank. And we had to exchange the old currency, which was called the yuan. The yuan is the Chinese dollar. The yuan for the new notes, Central Reserve Bank, we call them CRB notes for Central Reserve Bank. We had inflation, but the Japanese themselves left us alone. We continued Jewish life, observed all the major holidays and all holidays in our synagogue. We had a community, a Sephardic community of about 1,000 people, mostly from Iraq. And then there was an Ashkenazi community, mostly from Russia, who came after the Russian Revolution. And they formed their own community of about 3,000 people. And you have to picture this. When the Nazis were persecuting Jews in Europe, Jews had no place to go. Nobody wanted Jews. No one wanted Jews. They wouldn't let Jews in. Switzerland even guarded their borders to prevent Jews from coming in from Germany and Austria. The United States, France, and England stopped issuing visas to Jews. No one wanted Jews. However, there was one place in the world where anyone could go to, Jews or anyone. You didn't need a passport, you didn't need a visa, and that was Shanghai. So people found out about it in Europe, but they had to get a ticket. You needed a ticket to get there. And that could be costly because you had to pay people, bribe people, and get to a port where the ships are coming to Shanghai. But you have to picture, we had a Jewish community of 1,000, an Ashkenazi community of 3,000, and 20,000 German refugees came. 20,000. So the two communities formed a relief committee. They formed a soup kitchen. All those people came. Most of them didn't speak English. Most of them spent much of their life saving just to get to Shanghai. And these people needed to be fed, clothed, educated, and have jobs. So the committee would find apartments and jobs for them and schools for them and so on. And now life went on again with a new government, a new regime. But the Nazis found out about the Jewish community. They sent a man who was the commandant of the Warsaw ghetto, sent him to Japan. And he went to Tokyo and he said, "You got to do something about all these Jews." There were Jewish communities in Tokyo, Yokohama, Osaka, and Kobe. They were not political. They were businessmen. They kept to themselves. They didn't cause any upsetting. They didn't rock the boat. And the Japanese refused. They said, absolutely not. They refused. And there was a reason for that. A couple of reasons. When Japan went to war against Russia in 1904, they needed money. Here was a small country of Japan going to fight this huge bear of Russia. They needed money. They sent their finance minister to Europe, and he came to the United States. And there was a Jewish financier. His name was Jacob Schiff. And he was very angry with the Russians for their pogroms against Jews. When the Japanese finance minister came, he met with him. He says, "I'll help you raise money." And he helped him raise $300 million. In 1903, that was an enormous amount of money. The Japanese modernized their navy, and they beat the daylights out of the Russians. And the Japanese never forgot that a Jewish businessman helped them raise money and win the war. They never forgot that. But also, they did not want to antagonize Jewish organizations in the United States, because they had in the back of their minds, when there were peace talks to take place between Japan and the United States, perhaps these Jewish organizations could be the mediators. So they didn't want to antagonize any Jews. They left the Jewish communities alone in Japan. This man, the commandant of Warsaw Ghetto, then came to Shanghai, and he bugged the man, the commandant, saying, "You got to take care of all these Jews." And he came up with three diabolical plans to get rid of Jews in Shanghai. The military commandant refused for a whole year. At the end of a year, he relented to the extent that he declared that all stateless refugees from Europe had to go into the ghetto. Well, 99% of the refugees from Europe were Jewish. More than 99%, 99.9% were Jewish. So they had to go into the ghetto. Now, they never bothered us. We weren't refugees. And the Russians who came, they weren't refugees either. They came on their own. So all these German and Austrian refugees from Europe who were persecuted in Europe were now persecuted again. Ghetto life in the ghetto was terrible. Food was bad, water was bad, disease was rampant, rent was high, it was hard to get jobs. Life was tough. But the Germans were very industrious people. They produced two newspapers, one in German and one in Yiddish. And they were pretty soon little cafes opened up, like the cafes in Europe. In fact, it was called Little Vienna. they had Austrian pastries and coffee and things like that. So they made the best of a bad situation. But life was tough. So now we're at war. Japanese have occupied us, and pretty soon American planes came. At first they came at night. We could see the flashlights scanning the skies. American planes came over in formation, beautiful sight. But then they figured out the anti-aircraft fire didn't bother them. They came during the day, and they bombed us. Luckily, the military targets were all around, not within the city, but all around the city. And they would bomb these military targets. And when they left, there were fires that lasted days and days and days. But life went on. New government, new everything. My cousin went to visit my uncle and aunt, who had an apartment in a building overlooking the mansion of Wang Jingwei, the prime minister. One day, she went to visit him and she was leaving. And she looked across the street, there were two men standing there, just chatting. Pretty soon a limousine came by, driving slowly. And the prime minister, Wang Jingwei, was in that car. When they came up, these two men walked up to the car and just started blasting the car right in there and assassinated him right there, right in front of my cousin. And she was afraid. She hid in the bushes. And these two guys just took off. And he was assassinated right there. Nothing was said. Nothing was said in the papers. No one said a word. But 6 months later, there was a little article that said, Wang Jingwei went to Japan for medical reasons. Okay? He was long dead by that time. But things were tough. There's a book written by a man by the name of Bernard Wasserstein about the intrigue that went on in Shanghai. Every country had their agents. The Japanese had agents, Americans had agents, British had agents, Australians had agents, Germans had agents, and they were all working at cross purposes. And every once in a while, right in the streets of Shanghai, someone would be assassinated. Right there, on the main streets. And it would, some agent who was assassinated by another group. And this went on for the duration of the war. Okay. Well, the war lasted from 1941 to 1945. And it's an interesting story about a Japanese businessman. Now, the Japanese were brutal to the Chinese, absolutely brutal. If the Chinese got in the way, for any reason, he could have been beaten to within an inch of his life. They were brutal to the Chinese. But this Japanese businessman was a kindly man. He had done business with his British and American colleagues, and he wrote letters to them who were all now in camp. The Japanese interned all enemy subjects. The enemy subjects were British, American, Australian, Canadian, South African, all interned in camp to such an extent that there were no English language schools left. I mean, I couldn't go to school during the war. There were no schools left. Well, this Japanese businessman was a kindly man. He wrote letters to his colleagues in camp, and he said, our countries are at war, but we are still friends. And he would send an occasional food package, but he would send letters. The war ended, Japan lost, and this man was being sent back to Japan. And his British and American colleagues came out of camp, and they gave him a farewell party. And at this farewell party, he was asked if he would say a few words. But he spoke very broken English. So he got up and he said, I am very honored that you give me this farewell party. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart and from my wife's bottom too. Okay? True story. Okay, so the war ended. A couple of weeks later, after the war, Chinese and American troops arrived to relieve the Japanese, and the Japanese left. They went back home, and Americans and Chinese troops. And during the war, President Roosevelt promised Chiang Kai-shek that Shanghai would be returned to China. And so now we were under another regime with capital in Nanking, called Nanjing. Okay? Oh, great. Okay, thank you. A new regime. Now, the Chinese, as I said, were suppressed under the British. They were downtrodden. They were doing just menial jobs. They had no rights earlier. Now, they're the leaders. And we became the foreign devils. They call us a foreign devil. They call us foreign beggars. They call us all kinds of bad names. And we became foreign devils, foreign beggars. So we have a new regime and a new currency. New currency was called the gold yuan, supposedly backed by gold, and it wasn't. It was issued in October 1947 at the rate of 4 gold yuan to 1 US dollar, 4 to 1. That lasted about a month, and inflation took off. And inflation was so bad that if you got paid in local currency, you'd spend it as fast as you could, because the next day it wouldn't be worth as much. Inflation was so bad, there are very few places in the world that experienced that kind of inflation. To give you an example, the rate was 4 to 1 in October 1947. By October 1948, the ratio was 1 million to 1. And 6 months later, it was 6 million to 1. You would spend it as fast as you could if you got paid in local currency. My cousin worked for the US Army. She had a job that earned $100 a month. On payday, there was so much local money, she had to take a taxi to get home because she couldn't carry it all. I mean, there were horror stories like that. We had people who took 2 full bags of money to do 1 day's grocery shopping. The inflation was wild, absolutely wild. But I'm reminded of the story in Germany after World War I. They had wild inflation too, really wild inflation. The story of a man who ordered a cup of coffee. And he sat down, drink his coffee, and he was chatting with a friend of his. And he chatted with a friend of his for 15 minutes, and he finished his coffee. When he ordered the cup of coffee, it cost 50 marks. When he got up 15 minutes later, not 50 marks anymore, it cost 75 marks. It had gone up while he was sitting there having his coffee. Inflation was so bad then. That's the kind of inflation we had. It was pretty bad. But Shanghai American School opened. It was the first English language school to open after the war. And my parents sent me to the Shanghai American School. Now, as you may know, schools in the United States are co-ed. Well, I had gone to a boys' school, and suddenly I come to school and there's girls. There's girls. It was a brand new experience for me. I wasn't used to a school with girls in school. And that was, I got an education just being there. And it was a good school. I want to back up a minute. Our treatment by the Japanese during World War II. I told you that they had in their minds Jewish organizations to mediate peace talks. But the Japanese left us alone. They made all the German and Austrians go into the ghetto, but we were left alone. They, in fact, encouraged us to continue doing what we were doing. We celebrated all high holidays in Shanghai. We celebrated even the lower holidays, Tisha B'Av, things like that. And to give you an example, I was bar mitzvahed under Japanese occupation. I was bar mitzvahed under Japanese occupation. So they left us alone. They truly, truly left us alone. So now We're under a new regime in 1947 with capital in Nanking, new currency, new police force, new ideology. And we were the foreign beggars. But life was still good. Americans came. And I grew up in a British system. The British were very reserved, very, very reserved. Clothing was very reserved, nothing outlandish, no bright colors and things like that. Americans came with optimism, joie de vivre, humor. The clothing was brighter. Everything was much more upbeat. So it was a new experience for me, new experience for everybody there. Americans with optimism. So, again, life was good. Life was good. However, Chinese communists were holed up in an area in northwestern China. They broke out of that and they went north, went to the border, and the Russians armed those Chinese communists, and they started coming south. And when they came south, they got stronger and stronger. Whole divisions of the Chinese army would switch over to the communists, because again, the government was unpopular and very corrupt, Chinese government. So they were unpopular and they would switch over to the communists. And the communists came south. They occupied Beijing, they occupied Nanjing, and they surrounded Shanghai, 1949. I was a senior in high school at that time. I was a senior in high school. And I hadn't completed my final exams. And the Chinese, in the meantime, were loading up the ships along the river with the gold of the entire country. They had gold taken from all the banks, everywhere, brought to Shanghai, loaded on the ships. And when the ships were loaded with the gold and the big shots from the Nationalist Party, they sailed down the river and across to Taiwan. And then the People's Liberation Army entered the city. And there was shooting in the streets. I could hear the shooting. They entered from the south. And the shooting got closer and closer and closer. And I hadn't finished my final exams. No final exams, no diploma. So it got closer until it was right in the streets of our apartment building. I could hear it right out on the streets. There was shooting there. I waited, and it went north, slowly went north. And I called the school. When it went north, I called the school. School was open, giving final exams. And when it went north far enough, I could hear the shooting going further away. I jumped on my bike, rode to the school, I took my final exams and I passed. Now they occupied Shanghai on May 25th, 1949. And we were in American school, we were going to have graduation on May 28th. Now it's an American school and the communists were very anti-American. And we didn't know if they would allow us to have graduation or what. They didn't say a word. So we continued with our graduation. By that time though, half the school faculty was gone, half the school students were gone. They had left earlier before the communists took over. And our class was half the size that it was at the start. And our graduation took place and 11 students graduated that day. I was one of the 11 that graduated and I got a diploma. So, communists took over, new government, now capital in Beijing, new currency, new police force. The fourth one in 8 years. We had four different governments in 8 years, each with different ideology, different currency, everything. Wild inflation. There was something I want to show you in my book. We had money from way back, and this is wrapped.
Here, Ellis, I have notes.
Yeah, and I'm trying to break it open.
Okay, I know.
Oh, good. Okay, thank you. Okay. And this is the book I wrote, Shanghai I Knew. And I have a lot of things. Now here is a 1 cent piece. And it was that size, actually that size. 1 cent piece. And here's a 5 cent piece. 5 cent piece. And this was issued by the Central Bank of China in 1940. So now, remember, we've gone through 3 changes of currency since then, when the communists took over. And I calculated what this was worth at the official exchange rate when I left. When I left, the communist currency was 23,000 to one US dollar. And I calculated that this, when I left, was worth 1/100 trillionth of a US dollar. Okay? That's the kind of inflation that we encountered in 8 years. 100 trillion. And the interesting part was when this was issued, you could buy things with it. You could buy trinkets, you could buy candy, you could buy tofu on the streets. You could buy things with this at that time. It was worth 1/100 trillionth of a US dollar when I left. So, life went on. The communists allowed one ship to come in and take out everybody who wanted to leave. And in September 1949, my mother and I left. My father chose to stay, and he said, well, they'll open the ports and we'll do business with them. Well, they never opened the port for a long, long time. My father had difficulty earning a living. So we left. I had applied to come to the United States as an immigrant. Immigration laws were such that if you apply to come to the States, you cannot set foot on American territory, otherwise the application is canceled. But you can renew the application in the place in line that you were if you leave within 30 days. Well, the ship landed in San Francisco, so my application was canceled. But we had relatives in San Francisco. We stayed for 3 weeks, and my mother and I took a train up to Canada, and we had visitor's visas in Canada. Now the Chinese communists only allowed people to leave with $50 US on them. So my mother and I had $50 each. We arrived in Canada with $100, which doesn't last very long. Got a visitor's visa. Visitor's visa in Canada says, you're not allowed to work. Well, we had no choice. I got a job as soon as I could. And 6 months went and passed, and our visitor's visa expired. After a few months, we got called by the Canadian immigration, and we're in Vancouver, sitting across the desk of a very, very British gentleman, most British gentleman. And he speaks with this British accent, and he says, are you aware that your visa has expired? Oh yes, yes, we know that. And what do you plan to do about it? Well, we have no money and we have no place to go. Oh, and he said, most irregular. He said, don't leave town without informing us. Okay. In the meantime, they were investigating us. And they found out we didn't break any laws, we didn't deal in drugs. We were just two people trying to have a decent life. They interviewed our neighbors. They interviewed my boss at work. My mother belonged to a temple, Shaolin ascetic temple in Vancouver. They interviewed people in the temple, and they found out, you know, we were just ordinary people. And we get a letter a month after that interview, from Canadian immigration, ordering us to leave the country in 30 days. Well, that was terrible. I remember walking around with like a dark cloud over my head. I was 20 years old. I just expected the world to come to an end in those days. It was just a terrible feeling. So they were investigating us. In the meantime, my quota numbers in the United States came up. and the Korean War was going full blast. So I went to see American consulate in Vancouver, and I said, you have a draft down there in the United States. He said, oh, you don't have to worry. They've got enough graduates from all the high schools to fill all their quotas. They won't bother with you. Well, the American consulate told me that. I told my friends, my mother, my relatives, the American consulate is not going to take me. Well, the draft law was such that you didn't even have to be an American citizen to be eligible for the draft. You just had to be a resident, a legal resident. 9 months after you arrive, you're eligible for the draft. And 9 months to the day I was in the Army, I arrived on March 2nd in the United States, and on December 2nd, 1952, I was in the Army, okay? And it was a very interesting experience. I knew Morse code in those days. In high school, I built an oscillator, and we sent Morse code. So they sent me to signal school, San Luis Obispo, California. I went to signal school. And it's a 6-month school, and they test you every 2 weeks to see your progress in on Morse code. And I did well because I knew Morse code. I came in second in my class. I had a buddy who failed every test of the entire course, the 6-month school, including the final exam, okay? Well, I was second in class, and I went to Korea, and he went to Paris, France. I thought to myself, who's the smart one and who's the dumb one? But I have to admit, it was a good experience for me. I matured a lot, and I benefited a lot. And I want to say, this country has been good to me. I'm very proud and happy to be here, and I'm thankful for my treatment here. I got a college education thanks to the GI Bill. I got a job, a wonderful job as a result of the college education. And it's a wonderful experience to become American. And I'm happy and thankful to be here. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you. By the way, I became a radio operator. When I went to Korea, I became a radio operator, okay? And so I get to my unit, and they look at my credentials and say, you can't operate radio. I said, why not? I graduated from radio operating school. No, you can't operate radio. Because you're not an American citizen. You might come into contact with classified information. So they gave me a job as a supply man, supply a network of 7 radio stations with their transmitters, receivers, batteries, tubes, and all of that. And one of my responsibilities was to furnish them with their top secret codes once a week, okay? I couldn't operate radio because I'd come into contact with classified information, and I was just distributing top secret codes to these radio stations.
Weren't you a citizen as soon as you became a serviceman?
No, you don't become an American citizen until you get sworn in. Now, it normally takes 5 years to become a citizen. 5 years. But I was sworn in a military court in Seoul, Korea. And I became an American citizen in Seoul, Korea, in a military court there. Yeah. And so I'm very thankful. I'm very thankful for my military experience because it helped me a lot, and I benefited a lot as a result of that. So it was a good experience.
Did your father ever get over here?
My father, he stayed in Shanghai till 1953, and he found out he couldn't earn a living. That's an interesting story. He had shared an apartment with an Indian man by the name of Tata. The Tata family was very influential in India, and he shared his apartment with Tata. And the way to leave China in 1953 is you have to take a train down to Canton and then either a bus or another train to Hong Kong. And he went to Hong Kong and he kept in touch with Tata by correspondence. And Tata said 3 weeks after he left, the secret police came to arrest him. In those days, people used to just disappear off the streets of Shanghai. But he tried to do business in Hong Kong, and he went to Manila, and went to Tokyo, and then he went to stay with my mother in Vancouver. And they became Canadian citizens, both of them. As a matter of fact, he was crossing the Pacific, coming this way, when I was going to Korea, going the other way. Yeah, but he stayed as long as he could and became a Canadian citizen, and he became a financial assistant to a big finance here in Vancouver. Yeah.
What happened to all your brothers and sisters?
I'm an only child.
Oh, I
see. I have an only child. Yeah. So I had, and you know, it's interesting because when I grew up as an only child, I was lucky because, as I mentioned, my grandparents had 10 children, and each of them married, had families of their own. And I had dozens of cousins in Shanghai, lots of cousins. So I had a lot of company as I was growing up. But I had no siblings. I had no siblings in Shanghai. Yeah, right. So, and I want to say it's been a wonderful experience being an American citizen as a result of that. I'm very thankful. I'm thankful for the GI Bill. I'm thankful for the treatment this country has given me. So it was worthwhile. Yeah. Any more questions?
Very good.
Thank you.
Yeah, when you were in Shanghai and refugees from Europe came, did you have any personal contact with them, you or your family?
Well, my family, after the communists took over, went all over the world. But we had contact with family and friends all over. And in fact, the Shanghai American School has reunions now every 3 years. And we're going to have one this coming June. We have reunions. And since the graduates are all over the United States, we have reunions in many, many places. We had one in Los Angeles, in Washington, D.C., in Tennessee, in Indianapolis, whoever wants to conduct a reunion, we have it in that city. And we had one in Salem, Massachusetts. So we have them all over. And we're finding out now, of course, there are fewer and fewer people because people are dying off as alumni. And so we do have contacts with people all over the world, and as an example, our alumni came from Australia, Hong Kong, Germany, Spain. We found people, Italians who came from Italy, and Spaniards who came from Spain. So we had quite an international gathering whenever we have a reunion, and we've been in touch with a lot of people that way because of this dispersion after the communists took over. Anyhow, I'm thankful for your attention. You're a great audience. it would have been nice if, you know, the Melanesia had your full complement of people. But we'll do that again, perhaps, sometime soon.
Alex, thank you. That was
very good. Thank you. Thank you.
About a young boy growing up in Shanghai.
A big one?
A movie came out about a young boy growing up
in Shanghai.
Growing up in
the Empire of the Sun. Yeah. I did the things that he did. I rode my bike where he rode his bike. And there was one scene there where he was on the roof of an apartment building, a plane went by and he waved. I did the same thing. I was in our apartment, I waved at the pilot. The
bombs were all over the place, and he was on.
Yeah, yep.
He was a young kid, like 11, 12 years old. Or
yes,
younger.
Right, yeah. I did
very
the same thing he
movie.
Did. I went to see that just because of that. And then there was another movie made called Shanghai Ghetto. And it was done by one of the ghetto residents' daughter and son-in-law. And they interviewed him. He lived in the ghetto. And they interviewed him and filmed the buildings that he attended and lived in and worked at and so on. And it was first introduced in New York one weekend. And the man and the daughter and son-in-law were there, and I went to see them. And I said, unfortunately, you know, to the guy, I was there the same time he was, but we never met. Mm. We never met. But that was an interesting movie, and it's still available. You can get it from public libraries and things, called Shanghai Ghetto. Yeah.
This story, the way you handle this, was absolutely enthralling. I mean, it was beautiful. It's a shame you can't speak to a much larger audience. It's a shame even the wives should have been here to see this, to listen to you.
Yeah, it would have been nice.
Amazing.
We'll do it again.
Are the Japanese still that good to the Jewish people?
Well,
today.
Today, it's a different environment today. In Shanghai, there are some 200 Jewish families, business people, who are there, being sent there by their companies. And the temple, the synagogue that I was bar mitzvahed in, is not used as a synagogue during the year. It's a government office building. However, during the high holidays, from Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur, they clean up the building, and the Jewish families use that for services, even today. They do use that. They petition the Shanghai government, and the Chinese government, by the way, is very understanding and accommodating to Jews, especially to Jews. Every time there's a Jewish organization that has a ceremony about our welcome in China, we invite an official from the Chinese government to attend. And every organization that conducts the ceremony thanks the representative of the Chinese government for the reception that Jews have had in China. Now, the thing I'd like to point out is that Jews have been in China since the 11th century. Jews came along the Silk Road from Asia, trading along the Silk Road from Central Asia. And many Jews stopped and settled in a town in the interior called Kaifeng. And Muslims did too. There was a mosque in Kaifeng and a synagogue in Kaifeng. And it's interesting because the synagogue is on the street called the Street of the Jewish Synagogue. And it's there today. And we have found people in Kaifeng who claim to be Jewish. Now, they're totally assimilated. They look Chinese, they act Chinese, they speak Chinese, but they claim to be Jewish. So we said, well, what claim do you have to Judaism? Well, as a young woman said, our grandfather did not allow us to eat pork. And on Friday night, we had to light candles. So these people, there was a handful of people, were invited to Israel. And five of them took courses in Judaism in Israel and have come back as practicing Jews in Kaifeng. And we made contact with them. Our community made contact with them in the 1930s, but nothing came of it until recently.
Are there any Chinese Jews in Israel?
I don't think so.
I'll tell you a little interesting story happened to me. Back in 1976, Mao was still alive then. I was sent to, we had a plant startup, a big ethylene plant, outside Beijing.
Oh, really? Wow.
About 25 miles southwest of the city. Anyhow, we had an interpreter, a couple other guys like myself there, Westerners, and we ate in a big cafeteria there. And I told them I did not eat pork or ham or anything like that. So one day my interpreter says to me, Mr. Krabbins, are you a Muslim?
we have similar dietary laws with Muslims. You know, they don't eat pork.
Well, that's why he asked me. He didn't know about Jews, but he knew about Muslims.
Yeah, and you know, when this young woman from Kaifeng said, our grandfather didn't allow us to eat pork, that was a big deal, because Chinese eat a lot of pork, and they were not allowed to eat pork. So it was quite a big deal.
Could have been Muslim.
Muslim.
Yeah, could have been Muslim.
Well, that's right.
Just that.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you. That was very nice. Thank you.